today we're going to make a little magic. I'm going to show you how to take something perfectly ordinary, like craft paper, and transform it into what looks so much like leather, you're going to have a hard time believing that it's not. The process is actually pretty simple once you know what products to use, so let me get started and show you how to do this. This is our faux leather and what we're going to be making today. This is the project I'm going to show you how to take your faux leather and create. It's going to be a journal cover that will eventually fold up like this. Now, in order to make this, you have to understand the basics of how to make the faux leather. I'm going to start with some craft paper. This is 75-pound craft paper, and then we're going to use Ranger's Perfect Ink Refresher, and we're going to spray that on both sides of this craft paper. Ultimately, what this is going to do is saturate the paper, and as you start to work it in your hands, you're going to feel the texture of the paper change from this sort of crisp, crunchy paper-like feel. It's going to start to get supple and soft. So what you need to do is spray this on here on both sides. Now, I've tried several different kinds of craft paper, and they all behave a little bit differently, but the constant is that you have to spray enough of this to cover both sides and spend just a couple of minutes rubbing it in on both sides. That's going to kind of move the product into the craft paper, and you're going to do this again on both sides. Once you've spent a couple of minutes and you've worked this in, pick the paper up and crunch it in your hands. This is going to create the texture that you would ordinarily see in the hide of an animal skin and obviously in leather that you buy. Now, this is not done at this point. This is where the different types of paper are going to make a difference. I have found that with this particular type that we stock now, it takes a couple of times of wetting this and crumpling it before whatever change happens to that paper actually starts to happen. Now, you don't want this so wet that when you squeeze it, you can feel the product oozing out of it. That's not your goal. But I can already feel the changes starting to happen here. And as you do this and you handle this paper, once it's had the Perfect Ink Refresher in it, you'll feel the change. Now, once this happens, you can either use a heat tool to dry this, or you can let it air dry. The other thing that you can do if you want, I put this between the layers of a pressing sheet and I ironed it, and what I found was that helped dry the ink refresher out of it. It also will smooth this back out so that it's a little bit more like a regular piece of paper that hasn't been crumpled, but what it won't do is it won't remove all of these lines that have happened in here that make this texture that makes it look like leather. So once you have this dry, you're ready to work on it, and you can do various things with this. Here's a piece of green faux leather. You're going to notice the difference between this green and this piece that's just the plain paper of the plain color of the craft paper is that this is a double layer, which means it's got some more body, and this is a single layer. And I created this by taking two pieces of craft paper and fusing them together with Wonder Under before I applied the Perfect Ink Refresher and made this into the faux leather. Now, this piece that we're going to use to make our journal cover was actually three layers of craft paper. Again, I put them together with Wonder Under before I began the rest of the process. Now, if you're going to want to make your leather a different color, and I'm going to guess that you are because this is, it's nice, but it could be a lot more interesting, you're going to use Ranger's Distress Ink Pads. Now, I'm not using the reinkers. The color is really too pigmented in there. You kind of need to take it off of the ink pad, or at least that's been my experience. And I've used a variety of different colors. I've used aged mahogany, I've used walnut stain, vintage photo, I've used some chipped sapphire. This piece was done with walnut stain, and that's probably what I'm going to show you here. Now, a moment ago when I showed you how to use a single layer, what I want to show you now is when you take a piece that has two layers of craft paper that's been fused together, you're going to have to spend a little bit more time, it's going to take a little bit more of the ink refresher, and you're going to have to really massage that into the paper, because now what you've got is a double thickness, and again, when you make this journal cover, you're going to have a triple thickness, so it is going to take a little bit more time. If you want this a color, you're going to take your ink pad, and you're going to rub it on one side of the craft paper. Now, I'm not going to cover this entirely. because I don't want perfect coverage. Obviously, if you were looking at the hide of an animal and their skin, the color is not uniform all the way across, and so that's what we're going to try to achieve here. You don't have to let this dry. You're just going to come in now, and you're going to spray this. Turn it over. Spray this again. And then start massaging the ink refresher in. Now you'll notice that some of the distress ink is making its way under from underneath over to the top. This is going to be the quote-unquote wrong side of this piece, so I don't really mind one way or the other. After you do this a few times, you're going to get the sense, you will begin to feel when you have enough of the product on here, and I can tell by feel that I currently don't. And the other way that you'll notice also is that this will begin to soften up. So if I pick this up and try to bend this now, it's not flexing all that much, but if I spend another couple of minutes massaging the Perfect Ink Refresher in, it'll begin to give a little bit. Okay, this is beginning to get a little bit more flexible, so what I'm going to do now is pick it up and I'm going to start crumbling it. And yes, this is going to take a little bit more hand power than it did when I was working with a single layer, and obviously the three layers is going to require even more. But again, this is a process, and so you're going through multiple layers, which means it's going to take more of the ink refresher to really do the job to soften that paper up and make it supple and leather-like. Now what you don't want to do is add so much of this that when you pick this up and squeeze it, that the ink refresher runs off. That's too much, and that's sort of not where we're trying to go here. Each time you do this, the crumpling process gets a little bit easier, the paper becomes softer and more supple, and really does begin to feel like leather. And you'll know when you do this if you've added enough of the Perfect Ink Refresher. When this dries, if it feels crispy and stiff again, like it sort of is paper, then you know you need to come back and you need to do this again. Okay, I think this is just about done. Now, something that I didn't mention a moment ago that you can do, once this is dry, and I have done this on a couple pieces and I'm going to show you how to do it, something that you can do when this is dry is to come back with your ink pad and you're going to just gently brush it across the top, and it's going to hit the places where you've made the creases and the folds, and it's going to create some more texture and it's going to give it more of a leather-like look. Now, I did not do that here, but I do want to show you how to do that in case you want to give that a try. It's kind of a fun thing that you can do to experiment with. This piece was done with Distress Ink. This is Pine Needles. So now that it's dry, and you really need to wait until everything is dry to do this, because if you don't, the moisture and the ink refresher that's in this piece of paper is going to take the color where you've hit it on here, and it's going to wick it out, and you're not going to get that kind of look that we're looking for, which is just so that the creases are highlighted. So again, I'm going to come in very lightly and just brush the ink pad across the top, and you can see what happens. And this is very much like magic because it becomes much more three-dimensional and the piece isn't so flat-looking anymore. So again, this is an option that you can use if you want. You can leave it plain as I did on the larger piece, but either way, you can make some great-looking faux leather. While your faux leather is drying, you can be making decisions and working on the piece of fabric that you want to use to line your journal. What I've used here is a piece of white-on-white fabric. It started out looking like this, and when I got through with it, it looked like this. It's kind of this funky, rosy, brownie color that I thought worked really well with the color that I made the faux leather. I achieved that by using Ranger's Color Wash. I mixed a combination of espresso and wild plum, and I'm going to show you next how you can do that. It's just going to be a quickie segment that shows you how you can take your plain fabric and add some color to it. We're set up in the sink now, and this is how I, and dye is not technically the right word because we're using paint, but I'm going to just use the word dye. This is how I'm going to add color to this fabric. I have a small bowl with some water in it, and I'm going to add some of the wild plum, and then I'm going to add some of the espresso because I want to tone this down. By itself, the wild plum is just way too dark. And I have the feeling that's not going to be enough. You'll have to play around until you end up with a concoction that you're satisfied with. And I use one of these brushes, and I'm going to mix this up, and I can kind of see what it looks like. And you can see how brown that's become now. I think I'm going to add a little bit more water. I think that's a little darker than I want. Okay, that looks pretty good. I'm going to put some gloves on so my hands stay human colored. Now this fabric is not prepared for dye, so what I'm going to do is I need to get it wet first because otherwise it's not going to absorb the paint. And so I'm going to just work this around. I'm going to work it enough until the water has penetrated whatever finish was put on this fabric to make it look crisp and pretty when it's on the bolt. And that's great when it's on the bolt. It doesn't serve our purpose here. All right. We got this piece. It's still nice and wet, so all I'm going to do is come in and I'm going to brush this on here. And honest to goodness, it really is that simple. Now, you might have to come back once you squeeze this off. It's going to lighten up a little bit. And because, again, this is paint, it's not chemically reacting with the fiber. It's just sitting on top of the fiber. So if you rinse this under the water, you're going to rinse the majority of that out. This is not going to be color fast, but for our purposes, it really doesn't matter. Now, if you find this isn't the color you want, go back and adjust your little dye bath there. Add some more brown, add some more wild plum, whatever it is you're trying to do. The one thing I do need to tell you, and I made this mistake, when you want to dry this fabric, do not put it on the ironing board and attempt to dry it. For whatever reason, the paint reacts with whatever is printed on the front of this fabric to make this white-on-white look, and it starts to kind of pick it up and move it around. So let it air dry, and then if you want to press some of the creases out, turn it over on your ironing board and lightly press the back, and that'll smooth it out. Once it's dry, you're ready to go, and we'll put that journal together. Before we talk about how to glue the fabric to your faux leather, one thing that I want to mention, this is a good sized piece that you'll need to make, but what I want you to remember is when you make your faux leather for this, don't make it a whole lot bigger than this template that I'm going to give you. Otherwise, you're going to spend a lot of time and energy creating this massive piece, most of which you'll end up throwing away, or part of which you'll end up throwing away. So when you make your faux leather, make it a little wider and a little longer, but don't make it much beyond that. Once everything is ready, and now what we're going to do is we're going to glue this piece together. So you have your faux leather and the back side, and you have your fabric that's ready to go. I use Sobo glue for this. It's a little thinner than tacky glue and just happened to be what I had nearby. So I'm going to put some Sobo glue on the wrong side of this leather. Now the one thing that I want to caution you have to spread this out. If you don't, if there's any puddles, it's going to absorb into the fabric and you're going to end up with unsightly blotches. So you have to work reasonably quickly so that the glue doesn't start to dry on you. But you want to get it spread out, as I said, evenly, or as evenly as you can. And in this case, I've put too much on, so I'm going to wipe it off and come back and spread this out until I have a nice even coat. And as I said, that's going to be important because you don't want this to show through your fabric. Once you get that done, you're going to just come in, lay your fabric down, and start from the center and work outward. Just press it on and let this dry. And then at that point, once this is dry, and we're going to just move on here, and for the sake of argument, we're going to assume that this piece is dry. What you're going to do next is take your template, lay it out on here, trace it, and cut it out. It's very straightforward. There's no mystery here that I need to explain to you. Once you cut it out, you might notice that there's a little gap where maybe the glue didn't totally adhere the fabric to your faux leather. Just come in with a finger and a very light amount, again, not too much or it'll soak through the fabric, of the glue, press it down so that everything is set. And then once you've done that, what I chose to do, I took this to my sewing machine and I stitched about 1/4 inch all the way around here so that I knew for certain that these two pieces were totally adhered. That's your choice. You don't have to do it. For that matter, you could use a zigzag stitch if you wanted. I just used a straight stitch. Once you have this ready to go, the next step is going to be to grab your signatures, and I'll give you the dimension that these signatures need to be to fit the pattern that I'm going to give you. We're going to put them in here, and we're going to make decisions about where to line them up, and then how we're going to actually stitch them in place. Now that this piece is all assembled, the next step is going to be to get our signatures aligned in here so that we know that everything is set up the way that it needs to be, and in this case it is, and we're going to make marks on the inside where the signatures are going to land so that we can put holes in. We're going to use a 3-hole pamphlet stitch. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stand this up. I'm going to come in here with a pencil, and all I want to do is mark where the center signature is. That's the one that I care about because both of the other ones are going to work off of that. So what I'm doing is coming in here, finding the center signature and just making a mark on the edge of the fabric, and I'm trying to make it light because obviously I don't want this to show after the fact. Once I know that I've got those marks in place, the next step is to grab a ruler and I'm going to come in and I'm just going to make a light line on here. Now what I'm going to do is we're going to start our holes 1 inch in from each edge, and then we'll find the center. So once you've done that, you're going to come in and you'll measure in 1 inch. There's 1. And there's the second one. Now this piece measures, oops, 7 3/4 inches, which means we're looking at half of that. I'll tell you what that is. I'm not going to do that in my head because I'm certain to screw it up, but I'll make sure that I note that for you. We're going to mark the center mark, and then we will come in and we'll stitch the first of the signatures in, and then after that, all we're going to do is line them up. We're going to stitch the center one in. We're going to line one up on either side, stitch those in place, and then this will essentially be done. I'm probably not going to put a closure on this. You can if you want, or you could simply tie something all the way around it, and that will be what holds it in place. I have put all of my holes into the cover of this now, and when you decide how far apart they need to be, you need to take into account how thick your signatures are. If you have just a couple of sheets of paper, then obviously you can put your signatures close together. So there's no real number that I can give you other than to use the thickness of your signatures as a guide. In my case, I'm about 1/8 inch apart here. I'm going to start with the center and I'm going to work my way out. So what I'm going to do now is I'm not even going to use a hole guide. I'm just going to kind of wing this. I'm going to take my signature and I'm going to place it in the cover where I expect it to sit, and I'm going to make certain that I'm equidistant from both edges, and I'm just going to come in with my pencil and make a mark where I know the hole has to be. And I'm going to do that for all 3 signatures. Once I have that mark made, I'm going to make certain that these are all aligned. I'm going to lay it out on the table. I'm going to come in here with my awl, and I'm just going to bore a hole. Flip it over. And this one's a little bit off because my page wasn't properly aligned, but I can fix that too. Okay. Now we're aligned. I like the way those holes look. So next we're going to jump into the three-hole pamphlet stitch. A three-hole pamphlet stitch is begun from the outside of your piece, and it's begun in the center hole. So I have my signature lined up inside the cover, and I've come in with, I have some number 5 pearl cotton that's just a brown that matches this cover, and I'm going to come in from the center hole into the inside, pull that through, making certain that I leave a nice long tail, and then I'm going to, whether you go to the top or the bottom doesn't matter, but I'm going to go out the next hole and make certain that you keep your holes aligned so that you're feeding yourself through the center set. I'm going to pull that through. Oops. Again, I'm just checking to make certain I have enough of a tail. Now I'm going to come up all the way, skipping the center hole, to the opposite end. I'm going to go in through the holes in my signature. To the inside, pull that all the way through. I'm going to reach underneath here and I'm just going to grab the tail and I'm just going to give this a tug to make certain that there's no length of string here that's kind of hanging around. Once I'm certain that everything is taut the way it should be, I'm going to come back to my center hole, push it all the way through, come out to the outside. Now when I do this, I like to make certain that I have my original string on one side of this long piece and the one that exits from the inside on the other side, and I'm going to come in and I'm going to tie a square knot across there to secure it. If you want to put a little dab of glue or fray check or something like that, you can certainly do that. Now you can leave these tails long enough to put some beads on if you want, or you can just trim them reasonably close, but make certain that you're sure that that knot is not going to come undone. Once you finish the first one, you're going to come in and align your next piece and put it in place, put the third one in, and then you're done. And at that point, as I said, I'm probably not going to put a closure on here. I might just use a piece of ribbon or something to tie this closed, or I think eventually the cover will crease and it will just stay closed. But you have your journal all set.